Get me the hell out of here. Look at that face!
I will catch out with him.
Yeah, I'm just gonna run home so I can get him something to eat.
Okay.
Alright.
Every year, the U.S. kills over 3 million adoptable animals. Many are killed simply to make room for more. It's a deadly cycle, one that proves our society is lacking in how we treat those under our care. There are rescues, volunteers, good people doing good things to battle a bad situation. All of whom would gladly turn their focus and spend their time on something else, should the problem ever go away. This is their story, and our drive to find a better plan by asking simply, what can be done, and how do we fix it?
You all right with this?
What? Yeah,
all right.
I thought I was in a campground.
This is our euthanasia room. We have two shorelines in the room, and we have state-certified euthanasia technicians that perform all of our euthanasia in the building. I have a staff of 9. They rotate through the euthanasia room. They are my intake staff as well, and so they rotate through the euthanasia room once to twice a week. They work together as a team, and they make sure that each animal is humanely euthanized. I'm gonna cry because this is a compassionate group of people. They have tears for everyone that they do. They hold each one. This is not the old way of just stick them and go. We're lucky in the state of Tennessee that we have approved use of some sort of tranquilizer. Just depends on what the vet who is over your organization allows you to use. But the state veterinary board has approved some pretty good drugs that can be used to sedate the animal so they feel nothing. They feel that first injection, which is in the muscle. It's just a pinch. And then they feel nothing after that. So the staff is able to really hold the animal and comfort them through the process.
There are certain animals that come in that may come in for different reasons. For example, an owner surrender situation, you know, most times animals come in, they come in for various reasons, such as people are moving or economic reasons, or there's something in the home that does not allow them to keep the animal anymore. So we will bring that animal in, we will test it, we will make sure that it passes our behavioral testing and is appropriate. There are other times animals come in and they display behaviors very quickly that they may have a bite history or may have other behaviors that require us to not consider adoption but rather euthanization because of a bite history. There are degrees of aggressiveness that we measure in dogs, and there are, the various degrees have certain requirements. For example, if you have a dog that is extremely aggressive, there is no choice. We cannot adopt that animal out to another family.
We have a list. It took us about a year to come up with the list because there are many things. A hit by car animal, of course, that there is no known owner. We don't have the funding here to care for such injuries. Animals with parvo. What a chance we would take if we kept that in the building and possibly spread it to the other animals. We have to think of herd health. Severe upper respiratory in some cats. They'll come in, their eyes are completely caked shut. They can't breathe, their noses are completely closed up because they are so sick from upper respiratory. Most of those calls, if it is an animal that's coming in, most of those calls are all made by our senior management staff and our veterinarian. That's not a decision that is ever taken lightly, just in case there's an owner that might step forward. But those would be the top four. I think Tennessee is, I will say this, a little more advanced than other states. One of the state laws is you can't euthanize an animal in the room with another animal watching.
Do you think they know?
The animals?
Yeah.
Yes, they know. We struggle here right now because what we have coming in are really the ones that nobody's gonna want. And so we're having to spend extra time. We're working on that behavior untreatable animal at this point in time. So now we're starting to really grab onto those behavior untreatables. This is the dog or the cat that nobody wants. What do we do with the feral cat? If Feral Friends is full and can't take any more cats into a colony, what other options do we have for that cat? And that's where we're headed. That's what we're looking for.
Not all deaths are unnecessary, of course. The good people at Young Williams know this and work hard to make the right decision. Sometimes euthanasia is the most humane answer, a time to say goodbye to an old or sick friend. But the mindless killing, driven by efficiency, is the problem and exposes a flaw in our system, to kill for space and to be tasked to do so. It's hard on both animal and human. According to the National Occupational Mortality Surveillance, or NOMS, veterinarians have among the highest suicide rates for all professions. Compassion fatigue is real, and for those who face it every day, it takes its toll.
Euthanasia is not an easy decision for anyone in any shelter ever. It's not something that they want to do. They don't go to work saying, I get to euthanize animals today. That's a burden that they take home with them every single day. So for those communities, is it you leave these animals outside to face uncertainty, whether again it's abuse or neglect, and it depends on the day. Some of our shelters may take in 6 animals today. If it's in the middle of summer, they may take over 80 animals a day. And if you don't have 80 people there the next day to adopt those animals, what do you do with them? When they have no other resources and they euthanize those animals so they can take in 50 more the next day, then they get flack from the community on why are you doing this to the animal. So compassion fatigue is huge in our industry because those people get it from both sides. They do this because they love animals and they want to make their community better, yet the community that they're helping also strikes back against them. So veterinary medicine is the only practice that euthanizes their patients. And so our veterinarians also have a huge burden of what to do best. And is it what to do best for that animal, what to do best for that shelter, what to do best for the community. So they face a lot of problems.
Dr. Glenn, what happened to this cat, do you know? The one with the little red...
Fire.
I was gonna say, that's what it looked like. A house fire?
Survived a
fire. Look at you, honey. I actually have a... Oh, look at him. Is he gonna be okay, do you think? He's looking... Oh, honey.
Look how the pads are just
red.
She's pretty raw.
She's a raw, but she's
still a good cat.
But she's purring still.
Yeah, she's really sweet.
Aww.
She's a guest. Yeah, she
so again, if this cat ended up in a shelter like that didn't have a hospital and have, you know, we have 11 veterinarians, they would be euthanized.
And what made you choose to get into shelter medicine?
I enjoy, well, here we have the high volume wellness clinic, so one day a week I'm in a shelter, so I still get to do some shelter medicine, but I love making a difference, more of the herd health approach. We help a lot of animals. We help a lot of animals here that have owners and, you know, situations where they can't afford to go anywhere else. So I enjoy being able to pretty much help those that wouldn't have a chance otherwise.
So what are the trade-offs for you personally?
Well, I know that we wouldn't be able to help those that, you know, that we help here. And so it's very rewarding work. I love it. You know, some of these cases, like the house fire cat, I mean, these are the cases that keep us coming back every day. I mean, owners are so grateful. They would have nowhere else to go. Here we have high volume, but, you know, it's the amount of animals that we help here in a day is tremendous.
Are you familiar with the phrase compassion fatigue?
Compassion fatigue is very real, and it's something that everybody has to find their own way in how to deal with things. And so, you know, finding things outside of work, you know, to keep your, you know, to you know, hobbies and things to keep you busy and keep your mind off of things and just give yourself a break, you know, is important. And but yeah, I mean, compassion fatigue is very real. So everybody handles it differently. You know, we all have our ways of stress relief. So, but I think the amount of good that we do is very rewarding, and it really drives us to, you know, to you know, make a difference every day.
Being in that situation is something we bumped into a lot. How do you deal with compassion fatigue?
We are lucky to have the University of Tennessee right here in our backyard, and they have the veterinary social work program. We have an intern from that program every year that comes to help our staff with compassion fatigue. She stays here on site 3 days a week. They have access to her 7 days a week, as they have access to any of the veterinary social workers in the program. These are all social workers that are doing their master's in veterinary social work, and so they understand the needs of shelter workers. So we have them on staff because we know compassion fatigue is real.
Well, at the end of every leash, or associated with almost every animal, there's a person. And so we specialize in the human side of things in the veterinary setting. And so that's really important for helping to create a place for people who are grieving about their animals to receive care, to feel like they're cared for. Veterinarians experience quite a bit of stress, and we're there to support the veterinarians with their stress.
You have to remember, too, that the same folks that are doing intake here are actually the euthanasia technicians. So they may have heard the story from the owner that's surrendering that animal 3 days ago, and then it's their turn to be in euthanasia. Try as we may, it never works out that they're not the person in here. So that's one of the biggest heartbreaks for them. For the staff, they clean these animals every day. They feed these animals every day. Of course it's a heartbreak. They get attached to them. No matter what you say, don't get attached, you're gonna get attached. You know that animal. You know that every time you walk up, he wags his tail because you're putting his food down for him. Or every time you walk to the cat's cage, he bats at you because he wants you to pet him. So those are sad.
So you sedate the animal, which is kind of scary. It's a shot in the hip. It's an injection in their hip. It's a weird environment. It's a room that they're unfamiliar with. Of course, there's smells. You know, everybody uses the bathroom or they vomit up. Can't prevent death. Everything dies. It's the circle of life. But a lot of animals die prematurely that shouldn't have to. So we want to be there for them, no matter how much toll it takes on yourself. You put so much out, sometimes you don't get to replenish it, but you know that in the end, it's the animal who you're there for. Even if it's their last moment spent with you or their last moment spent here, you get to be there.
What would you tell someone that came in and told you that they couldn't do your job because they love animals too much?
That's the reason that I'm here, is because I love the animals. It takes somebody who actually cares to do this job. You couldn't do this job if you were just here. You have to have it in your heart. You have to have the compassion. You have to have that love, that nurture for the animal, because you couldn't do it in that type of manner if you did not care that much. It would just be putting the animal to sleep and then putting it somewhere instead of calmly sedating the animal to humanely euthanize it. Euthanasia means peaceful death. That's what we should be doing. And that's what I always try to do.